you know, was kind of a marriage that just continued to go forward. And I think with Jade, then we went on to do, what was the song, 7 Days a Week, I think, for another show that utilized it. So you're right. It did reflect the fact that we had began to change the perception of how music was handled and certainly how it opened the door for crossing barriers and crossing lines that weren't always there.
Right. And then, like, the White Axe on the label, like Jeremy Jordan and Good to Go. Now, to be honest with you, I was kind of skeptical at getting the Try My Love album, but listening to it, I was like, it sounded like an album had Justin Timberlake would have been Jeremy's age at that period. It was definitely a good reflection of pop R&B, and you had some cuts from Al B. Sure and Kanye West.
Absolutely, and it was early. I mean, you know, we were very early with that trend, and you know, I think that later it was something that a lot of more people began to jump in on. But we were early in it. I won't say we were first, because I think that New Kids on the Block were really the first to be introduced as a major pop vocal group. And certainly I recall seeing them, but I wasn't, you know, I didn't think about it at the time, because Color Me Bad didn't come on at the heels of New Kids on the Block. New Kids on the Block had come and gone. And I'm saying, I think that was just a group that I recalled. And being from California and growing up around pop music, rock music, hip-hop, R&B, all of it, it all was the same to me, because my experience and the world that I lived in was not just one thing. It wasn't just black, it wasn't just white, it wasn't just rock, it wasn't just pop. It was everything. And so depending on which group of friends I was hanging out with and where I was, I was really being exposed to multiple cultures and multiple sounds. So by the time I became a record executive and started making music in that capacity, I think that's why my history reflects such a diversity in terms of the caliber and the types of groups that I signed, because I did sign pop acts with Color Me Bad and Jeremy Jordan, and pop R&B with Jade and, you know, Christopher Williams, and hip-hop with, you know, Ahmad and Hammer and, you know, things like that, Above the Law, and so forth and so on. So, you know, I was kind of in all the areas, because to me, music was just music. Mm-hmm. That's why it was so easy to make New Jack City, and to see the industry find it to be so revolutionary, I thought it was normal, because to me, I was making a soundtrack that would reflect what happens when you go into a club. When you go into a club, you hear everything. You don't just hear one thing. So I was thinking, wouldn't it be refreshing to have a soundtrack that was really a reflection of the experience that happens when you go out at night? You hear a little bit of this, you hear a little bit of that, you hear, you know, a good mix show. You hear some everything. You hear old school, new school, hip hop, pop, R&B. If it's big enough, you know, you hear a little bit of everything. I was just following what was the true or actual, you know, reflection of the world that we lived in my opinion.
Now, what was it about that period during the New Jack Swing period, late 80s, early 90s, that made it so special? Because it was, everybody was crossing over, Bobby Brown, New Kids, Paul Abdul, Janet Jackson, and the list goes on and on.
Absolutely, absolutely. And even though I was still managing and still being taught and still coming up when a lot of that was going on, I didn't really begin to make my imprint in music until the 90s. early to mid 90s. So I was influenced by, and I watched the Janet Jackson and the Paula Abduls and all those things that you mentioned, and absolutely they began to certainly tear down a barrier and prove that the consumer, that the target consumer at the time, was really less concerned about what genre of music it was as they were about what they liked. Mm-hmm. You know, if it was something they liked, they didn't care. You know, you didn't care if you were white and this was hip hop. You know, you didn't care if you were black and it was the right pop thing. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was really the beauty of having so many people breaking into different categories of the late 80s and early 90s.
Mm-hmm. So where was it, did you think, that started to turn, where music started to become more segregated and fragmented?
Well, yeah, I really think that as it moved into the 90s, it became all the more eclectic and diverse, the truth be told, because, you know, when you think about it, prior to that, you wouldn't have gotten a group like Color Me Bad having a number one black hit. That hadn't happened. Even when New Kids on the Block, and they were the precursor to all the boy bands, and I think they came in the 80s, I don't know, I wasn't there, But I think they came in the mid to late 80s. Color Me Bad didn't come along until the early 90s. And for them to have, they were a number one black act. They were number one on the R&B charts before they were ever top five on the pop charts.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just new. You know, that wasn't happening at that time.
Right. So basically, you disagree with the notion that when grunge and gangster rap came in, that was when the diversity went out the window.
Yes, that's really what I think.
Okay, because that's what a lot of people think. Like when Nirvana, Nevermind came out, that was like the death knell.
Yeah, I think that it's interesting. I think that music, we're at our best when we really allow it to showcase all kinds of things, where we expose both the listener and the music makers to a wider range of you know, a bigger selection or more of a mortgage board, if you will, of choices.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's great because then you begin to see different pieces of music in almost everybody's music. You see the effects.
Right, because I definitely agree with that, because like back then you had different lanes. If you didn't like this artist, you liked this artist. And then with certain artists sampling certain songs, like when PM Dawn sampled Spandau Ballet's Truth instead of Drift from Memory Bliss, nobody wasn't thinking to sample an 80s new wave cut.
I think you're probably right on that. I mean, the sampling sensation had already been, you know, obviously been a big thing because it was the cornerstone of all the hot rap product that was coming out, unless you were a record or something of that nature. But almost everything that was coming out of New York had a sample under it.
Mm-hmm.
Almost everything. So it wasn't, that part wasn't new, but to have an act like PM Dawn have a sample, that was new. And just to have an act like PM Dawn, like to me, we still haven't fully exploited groups of that type, The Roots and PM Dawn.
De La Soul.
What's the group that Will.i.am comes out of?
Black Eyed Peas.
You know, there needs to be more, in my opinion, groups like that. I think that's the new rock and roll, in my opinion. Because
mm-hmm.
it looks like it. It has a, you know, it looks like what the people of that genre looks like and everything. In terms of just being very cultural, very bohemian in the presentation, you know,
mm-hmm.
Multicultural in the members, all of that.
Yeah, I agree. Definitely a good vibe. You had the Native Tongues, Jungle Brothers, De La Soul, Moni Love, Queen Latifah, Stessa Sonic, the list goes on and on. What was your opinion on the whole boy band phenomenon in the late 90s, early 2000s with Backstreet Boys and NSYNC?